CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents Come In. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. Since man began, he has sought to penetrate the secret of the human heart, that beating muscle that perpetuates lifetimes. What would happen, we ask ourselves, if during a medical procedure to repair or replace a damaged heart, an unexpected change in the patient took place? The operation was successful, you had a new lease on life, but you left the hospital, not yourself.
That's a gorgeous rainbow silk scarf you've got around your neck, Janet.
That's the problem, Celia. I mean, the scarf hides the problem. Here, let me take it off.
Oh, great heavens. Those bruises on your neck. What happened?
This is why I had to see you. It's Jim. He tried to choke me to death last night.
Our mystery drama, Transplant, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by G. Frederick Lewis and stars Marion Seldes and Patricia Elliott. I'll be back shortly with Act One. The name James Barclay is not unknown to you. Extraordinary scientist, he is the discoverer of the RNK factor, the infallible prenatal test determining the nature of an embryo child, whether it will be born, aggressive, submissive, etc. A discovery that can affect the future of an entire nation. It is night, 4 o'clock in the morning to be precise. Barclay's wife, Janet, suddenly wakes. Hands are closing about her throat, strangling her.
Help! Jim! You have not my son. Get away, Jim. Stop. Stop. What are you doing? Let go of me.
What is that? Janet, are you all right?
I knocked the lamp off the night table. I'll put the overhead light on.
What time is it? It's still dark outside. Janet, what are you standing over there for? Now come back to bed.
What happened to you, Jim?
To me?
Don't you know what you were doing just now?
Janet, what's the matter with your neck? You keep rubbing it.
Don't you remember?
You don't even know what you're talking about. Honey, look at me. Janet, are you afraid of me? You are, aren't you?
I guess I am.
Well, I can you tell me why? What have I done?
I was asleep and I felt two hands on my throat squeezing. It was dark. I couldn't see it.
And there was someone in here trying to choke you? Allison, I'm taking my pistol and I'm getting up and going to search every room in this house. Why didn't you tell me there was an intruder?
Jim... Put that revolver away.
If there is someone here, I'm going to find
him. It isn't necessary. Put the gun away now, please.
Okay, if you say so.
Shut the drawer. There wasn't any intruder. The person who was trying to strangle me was you, Jim.
Me?
I was able to get away from you, and that's why I I'm sort of in shock, I guess.
Oh, my Lord. Darling, I was trying to strangle you? But honey, I was asleep. I don't know anything about this.
That's what makes it all so scary, Jim. You don't remember that you were trying to kill me. Hello?
Celia? This is Janet.
Janet, I was just thinking about you.
I was wondering if we could have lunch today.
Would have loved it, darling. I haven't seen you for too long.
You mean you can?
It's a darn Broadway Critics Award. Michael got the best play prize again, and it's about the fifth he's gotten. And I have to go along. Food is ghastly. Speeches, grisly. So boring, Janet. You've no idea.
I understand. I'm sorry.
You sound kind of funny, child. Is everything all right?
It isn't anything that I can talk about on the phone. What about tomorrow?
Tomorrow's out too, I'm afraid, darling. Oh, I'm simply devastated. See, Mike's going tonight to Hollywood to discuss a movie version of his play, and he won't go near the place if I don't come along. But we'll be back in 2 weeks.
2 weeks? I really have to talk to you before then.
Janet, you don't have to send up any more distress flares. You come over here right away.
Today?
Yes, today.
What about Michael and the play prize?
He'll just have to accept the honors gracefully. All by himself, won't he?
Now, you're sure it's all right?
Oh, I don't think Michael will be too upset. Besides, I've got something to tell you which I think only you will understand. So be here at 12. Bye.
I'll be there.
Michael. Michael Farnsworth Gray.
Whenever you use my middle name, I know you've decided to do something I won't be too happy about.
I'm not going to the award luncheon with you today. Janet's coming over, and we're going to have something here.
Celia, you know I can't abide these ceremonies alone.
Well, you just run along, and don't eat too many of those creamy things. You know what the doctor said.
I've been watching my weight for years.
So have I. Watching you get heavier and heavier. Now, darling, your health's at stake, especially since you've given up all forms of exercise. I don't know what's come over you. You loved hiking and stuff.
I've always hated exercise. And who's Janet?
James Barclay's wife. Do you remember him, the famous scientist? Well, Janet and I got to know each other in the hospital, waiting for you two to be let out.
You mean the James Barclay? The RNK factor man? I never met him in my life.
Oh, yes, you did. Both had heart operations at the same time. Of course you remember. Shared a room in the hospital.
You were never like this before, K44K.
K44K. That's the third time today you've called me by that poetic name.
What?
Never mind.
Well, if you won't come with me, you won't. Bye-bye, K44K.
Mike. You've really become a pill in the last 4 months. Now, I ask you again, as politely as I can, is that some secret code that I'm supposed to know?
So long. See you when I get back.
See, what a beautiful spot. I love this garden and this old-fashioned furniture.
You know that Mike wrote his first short story on this table?
I'm sorry. I thought I wasn't hungry, but I am.
Here's a good salad. Good to see you, counselor.
Nobody's called me that since I got married.
You don't do law work anymore?
Married to Jim? When would I have time?
Well, this will be the first time a lawyer's come to see me about her problems. I must say, Janet, that is a stunning rainbow silk scarf you've got round your neck.
Well, that is the problem. I mean, that hides the problem. Here, let me take it off.
Oh, great heavens. Those bruises on your neck. What happened?
This is why I had to see you, Celia. It's Jim. I think he tried to kill me last night.
What? Jim?
I know. I couldn't believe it at first either. I thought, I don't know what I thought. And if I hadn't been able to pull away, who knows? The terrible thing is, he doesn't remember doing it.
Oh, you poor thing.
There's something awfully wrong with him, Celia. In his right mind, Jim would never dream of such a thing. Jim loves me.
Well, of course he does. Janet, you just said in his right mind he'd never do it. Have you noticed much else different about him since the heart operation? I'll tell you why I ask. I think, since the heart operation, Mike's become a completely different person. For instance, he would never have considered selling any of his plays to Hollywood. Secondly, since he came home from the hospital, he simply stopped writing. He says he may never write again. Third, he was an avid outdoorsman. I mean, we always went camping once a year. We've got a garage full of equipment. Well, he looked at it the other day and he said, "What's this? I was never interested in hunting or fishing. Whose stuff is this?"
He's changed, see. But at least he isn't murderous. What I'm afraid of is that Jim might try it again.
Janet, you don't mean that.
I mean exactly that. Jim wasn't playing any games with my throat.
Oh, you must have been frightened to death.
I'm still not over it. One more thing. The day before yesterday, he started calling me a number. And when I say, "What's that mean?" he says, "What's what mean?"
Number? I've got the same routine from Mike. He calls me K44K. What's yours?
ZXY77.
ZXY77. That's a nice ring to it. How does Jim explain calling you that?
He doesn't. It passes right by him.
Incredible. What do you suppose changed our husband so completely?
Oh, see, I wish I could guess.
I wonder about the other girls.
I'd like to find out, too.
Five of us. The fearful five, remember? Having lunch and dinner every night in that hospital cafeteria, keeping each other hopeful. Madge Currier.
Her husband was the ambassador to Russia, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
He'd come back to have his open-heart surgery. Dr. Tyson operated on him that same week.
And Betty, of course. Betty Trumbakos. She's my neighbor right up on the hill there. Married to that shipping tycoon, Aristotle Trumbakos. You, me, Madge, Betty. Who was the fifth?
Myra. I talked to her once
a
week.
Of course, Myra.
Her husband's taken over the Philharmonic.
Yes, it's the conductor, Dimitri.
Let's ask them how their men are doing. You do Betty, and I'll do Madge and Myra.
Yes, and have they noticed anything different?
And if so, what is it?
Unless, I wonder. Oh, some more iced tea? The pitcher's still full.
Thanks. You wonder what?
Well, it occurs to me. You know, Mike is a great kidder. Do you suppose when Mike and Jim were sharing that room in the hospital, when they had their operations and recuperating, do you suppose they cooked this up between them and they're just playing some kind of a game?
No, I don't think so. And these black and blue marks on my neck don't think so either.
Oh, of course. How dumb of me. But the numbers racket could be a game. Me, K44K, you, ZXY77. But to attack you like that, Janet, it ain't funny. If you ask me, I'd try to get Jim somewhere for observation. And if he won't go, you ought to think about moving out.
I have, in a way. I've moved to another room, made it my bedroom. I've hidden his gun. And every night I lock my door.
Leonardo da Vinci, painter, scientific observer, inventor, researcher, equaled the accomplishments of 10 titans. The human body was his uncharted continent. The heart, he wrote, moves of itself and does not stop unless forever. Had Da Vinci lived today, what unnumbered secrets he could have probed. If that heart is tampered with, does it indeed alter the body and mind that houses it? I shall return shortly with Act Two. Two wives of two prominent men, one a scientist, the other a playwright, are disquieted by their husband's peculiar behavior. The writer has completely reversed his personality. The scientist has tried to murder his wife. Both men had undergone open-heart surgery. Had this anything to do with their metamorphosis? Janet and Celia have set about finding out. They're in the garden, where we left them.
Janet, you've decided me. I'm not going with Mike to California. I'm staying here and do some detection with you.
You will see you?
There's one other person we ought to talk to. I don't know if we could. That's Dr. Tyson. I mean, he's the one who performed all those operations. Maybe he could tell us something we ought to know, like what changes in personality to expect and so on.
What's troubling us is a lot more than changes of personality. Besides, in Jim's case, his triple bypass was done by Dr. Bob O'Brien.
You mean Dr. Tyson had nothing to do with Jim?
Oh, he was there. Dr. O'Brien is a much younger man. Jim's known him for years. Dr. Tyson was in the operating room all through it, but Bob O'Brien actually did the work. That's what Jim wanted.
Well, we'll begin with the girls, woman to woman. I'm hopeful.
Whatever they tell us will help. None of this, none of it adds up.
Thanks, Bob, for squeezing me into your office hours at such short notice.
Oh, not at all, Jim. How's my favorite cardiac patient?
Well, I'm not so sure, Bob. That's why I had to see you.
No? Any pains or tightness of any kind?
No. I think I'm in pretty fair shape. I get a little tired, but I knock off before exhaustion sets in. Bob, I wouldn't want Janet to know we've discussed this.
Fair enough.
2 weeks ago, Janet accused me of trying to choke her to death during the night. I don't remember any of it.
Anything else?
Well, she keeps telling me I'm a completely changed person since you performed the triple bypass. And last but not least, she says sometimes I refer to her not by her name or darling or anything like that, but I call her a number.
Oh?
Specifically, I call her ZXY77.
Do you?
Well, I most certainly don't. Why should I? She's moved out of our bedroom and sleeps in another room and locks the door every night.
Suppose I have a talk with Janet. I'm no psychiatrist, but at least I can talk to her as a friend.
Oh, thanks, it's a load off my mind. You know how it is. After a biggie like a heart operation, you're always a little doubtful you can pick up where you left off. I am beginning to doubt my sanity.
Jim, I'll do my best.
I don't believe it, Janet. Is that what Myra said?
Word for word. Dimitri came home after his first rehearsal with the Philharmonic, broke his baton in half and said, "Never again, the orchestra stinks, I won't conduct." This, mind you, about the Philharmonic. Of course there was an uproar.
Did she mention whether he calls her by a number?
Yes, he does. Myra is Q515.
That rules out a practical joke. Mike and Jim never met Dimitri. He was on another floor. We knew Myra, but they didn't know him.
Did you reach Betty?
No, she's still away. She's gone with her husband to that Greek island he owns. I left a message with Mrs. Doyle, the housekeeper, that I called.
About Madge Courier, I did get to her. You remember the ambassador came in from Russia and he was operated on, I think, a day before Mike was. Wait till I tell you about him.
Celia, I'm home.
Join us in the garden, Mike. Back from California. Look at what he's wearing. I tell you, a year ago, Michael Farnsworth Gray wouldn't have been seen dead in such an outfit.
Janet, don't tell me this was the same lunch you two were having when I left for California.
Hello, Michael. Congratulations on the picture.
Oh, Michael isn't going to let them make a movie out of one of his plays, are you, darling?
Who says I'm not? In fact, I am.
Well, wonders never cease. You were so pure once.
Well, I'd better be on my way. You two will want a little time alone.
No, don't go, Janet. Please.
Well, I have to. Lots to do.
I'll walk you to your car.
Bye, Mike.
The new Michael Farnsworth Gray is just too much for me. Now, what about Madge and her ambassador husband?
Well, he's got himself transferred to Washington, got himself appointed as advisor to the president, and Madge is stunned. He's never had any ambition before. I've arranged to see Dr. O'Brien. We've known him and his wife a long time. Maybe Bob can clear up this mystery.
Will you let me know, Janet? I'm not going to Lotus Land. I want to stay here and get to the bottom of this.
Janet, I think perhaps you're dramatizing the situation.
But how can you say that, Bob? I tell you, Jim tried to strangle me. There's been a complete personality change. And sometimes he calls me by a number.
What number does Jim assign to you?
A sign? Well, that's a funny word to use.
I used the wrong word. What number is it?
ZXY77.
Oh. Frankly, I don't know what to make of it.
Well, I'm not the only one. Jim's hospital roommate, Michael Gray, he calls his wife by a number, too.
Gray. Morris Tyson did his surgery. I studied under Tyson, Janet. No one better in thoracic and cardiovascular surgery.
So you can't put your finger on anything it might be?
So far as I can see, Jim tolerated the procedure very well. If there's something bothering him, it's got nothing to do with the surgery.
Then why has it affected every one of the five men who had that operation in that hospital that week?
I can tell you one heart patient who didn't. Who feels fine, was operated on in that hospital by Morris Tyson himself, and has a new lease on life.
I'd like to meet him.
All right. He had a rheumatic heart, severe valvular damage. After surgery, the man recovered, never attacked his wife, and never changed his personality.
Well, I'd like to talk to him.
You are? It was me. All right, Janet, are you satisfied? Conclusion. Different patients react differently.
Bob, would you mind if I talked myself to Dr. Tyson?
Of course not. Oh, and give my regards to Jim, will you?
Yes, and you remember me to Mary. She's a darling.
Darling Mary. Good old W66W.
Celia, I came over just as fast as I could. I saw Bob O'Brien. He wouldn't go along with anything I said. Didn't think Jim was behaving extraordinarily. It was a standoff. Then I got up to go and I said to him, remember us to Mary, his wife. He closed the door. I was standing outside, fumbling in my bag for the car keys, when I heard Bob say through the door very clearly, darling Mary, good old W66W. Just like that.
So your heart specialist also calls his wife by a number. Oh, it makes no sense.
Celia, am I starting to hear things that aren't said? I mean, the door was closed, so I didn't see him say it.
When you were talking to him, did he seem strange in any way?
No. Well, he was his old self, considerate, concerned, everything you could ask for in a doctor.
Yeah, none of that glazed look that Michael gets when I'm talking to him. Oh, that man makes me so furious. Janet, I'm having so much trouble with him. And he's as dead set on moving to California as I'm adamant about staying here. Oh, someone's at the door. I'm coming! Mrs. Doyle, what are you doing here? Did you walk down the hill? I know you don't drive.
Begging your pardon, Mrs. Gray, I had to speak with you myself, not over the telephone.
Well, come in, come in.
Oh, no, I see you have company.
Mrs. Doyle, what is it?
Have mercy on us. Oh, have mercy on us. It's Mrs. Cumbrock.
Oh, Betty, something's happened.
Oh, just a few minutes ago, this cable came from me. It's from Mr. Tom Brockles in Greece. you read it.
Mrs. Trumbaco drowned yesterday and having body buried in Athens will notify you upon my return. Aristotle Trumbaco. Betty. Drowned.
I hope I haven't kept you up, Bob.
No, I was waiting for you, Dr. Tyson.
Is W66W still up?
My wife? No, she's gone to bed. We won't be disturbed. I've just been reading up on our files, making sure everything's in order. There'll be a new set of patients coming our way, so I want the decks cleared.
I'm afraid, Bob, everything is not in order. I suppose you read about the death of Tom Brokaw's wife, some island off Corfu. She drowned.
I did. I'm sorry about that. I might have handled it differently. Aristotle is going to miss her.
There was no alternative. She became too inquisitive. There is too much at stake for our procedure to be jeopardized now. That's precisely, Bob, why I've come to see you, the wife of one of your patients.
You mean Janet Barkley?
Yes, I do. She may be dangerous. All day yesterday, she sat outside my office waiting to see me. Now, I had to go out the back way to avoid her. Today, she managed to catch up with me as I was going into a cardiology conference at the hospital. She had learned that Umbraco's wife had drowned. She said it wasn't possible. She knew the girl, Betty. Five wives had become friendly the week we did the X and K batches.
I know. They formed a club of sorts.
Well, the Barkley woman had done some investigating, she told me, and she knew Betty Dombrakos was an excellent swimmer, that she must have been killed. Therefore, Bob, since you selected James Barkley to become one of us, you will have to find a way to rid us of his wife.
If this were not such a serious situation, I would be tempted to quote from Alice in Wonderland. You will remember when Alice mysteriously grew taller and taller, she said, "Curiouser and curiouser," which is indeed my reaction to what we have heard so far. Curiouser and curiouser. For more and more, join me when I return shortly with Act 3. We are putting together a jigsaw puzzle of delicate and deadly pieces. Five men, leaders in their field, a scientist, a playwright, a great conductor, a shipping tycoon, and an ambassador have undergone heart operations within 1 week. The scientist's wife, Janet, horrified by her husband's attempt to kill her, tries to find a link between his operation and his new personality. In fact, each of the wives reports a decided change in their men. All but one of the wives, who has mysteriously drowned.
Tell me, Dr. Tyson, what else did Janet Barkley suspect besides Betty's death?
That there must be unseen forces that have changed husbands. She asked about how you handled her husband's operation. Now, was it possible that when you performed the arteriotomy and constructed the grafts, that some foreign substance could have entered Barkley's body? Or at the point where the three proximals were constructed to the ascending aorta?
She's certainly done her homework.
Her own words were, when Dr. O'Brien put Jim on the heart and lung machines, what else did those machines pump into him beside blood and oxygen?
Barkley came to see me. He thinks his wife Janet is imagining things.
Well, I've had him sent to Athens to be with Tom Brokaw in case there's trouble. Barkley told his wife he had to attend the scientific meeting. Now it's your turn to move.
How much time do I have?
The last thing Janet Barkley said to me was that if I couldn't or wouldn't give her a satisfactory explanation, she would use her legal connections to alert Interpol and ask them to investigate whether Betty Tom Brokaw died naturally, accidentally, or was murdered.
Janet, I set aside all my appointments this morning so that I could see you.
I think it's too late. I'll keep on trying to find out what's in back of all this, but I'm afraid that what I am fighting for is something I've already lost.
What do you mean?
I've lost the man I married. And now I'm married to a man I don't know and don't love.
Janet, you have to make allowances.
Don't tell me it takes time to recover. I know all that. I'm not expecting Jim to, well, juggle barbells or do anything strenuous, but it's his mind that needs to get well, if it's not too late, which I suspect it is. And I'm only one of four wives with whom I spend hours and days together at the hospital that fateful week. They all say their husbands are strangers. We're like sisters. We were five. Now we're four. Who knows when we'll be three or two.
Janet, would you mind I'd like to take your blood pressure.
Why?
Your face is flushed, and I think, for everyone's sake, I'd like to check you out. Anything you think or say is bound to have a reaction upon your body. Right through that door is the examining room. You stretch out on the table, and I'll be right there.
Well, how does it read?
Blood pressure's a little on the high side. No. Stay right there. Let me check your pulse.
Is it all right if I talk?
Oh, certainly.
I have to say, I do feel so much better and reassured when I'm talking to you. Do you know?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Is my pulse normal?
Oh, a little fast, perhaps, but it's nothing. I don't know. Maybe you've been pushing yourself too hard. Janet, are you feeling all right?
Well, I guess it's the strain, but I am getting a whopper of a headache.
Well, I can give you something for that. And here you are. Here, take these two tablets. Here, I'll just pour you some water. If you can spare the time, I'd like you to undergo a stress test, Janet. It's simply a treadmill that's monitored by a doctor, and you do some controlled walking so we can measure how your heart is reacting. We have one here in the office. We'll take an EKG, and as I said, there's a specialist and a nurse with you all the time.
Is it like the stress test Jim had, the one that turned out positive?
The same.
Well, do you really think that I need that?
Well, let's play it safe, huh? I'll check when the doctor's free, and we'll take care of it right now. Come on back into my office. Oh, good. They'll be able to schedule you in a few minutes. You feeling any better now?
I'm sort of woozy.
You relax right there, and let's go over what's bothering you, huh?
Mostly that I can't make sense of what's happened. There's no explanation.
Janet, you know very well that sometimes there isn't any explanation. Ponce de Leon was absolutely positive the Fountain of Youth existed in Florida. And he was determined to find it. He didn't because there isn't any Fountain of Youth. Thousands searched for the gold of El Dorado. Even Sir Walter Raleigh went looking. There was no gold. No lost continent of Atlantis. No treasure hidden in King Solomon's mines. I'm sure Jim would agree with me.
Jim's gone to Greece. I don't know why. Scientific meeting.
The point is, Janet, perhaps there are some things better left unknown. Do you understand?
Yes.
There is no explanation. And it's a mistake to search for one. Janet. Janet, can you hear me? Good. Hello, Dr. Tyson.
Yes, Dr. O'Brien.
I have the patient here in my office. I shall be sending her along to you. I'll have an ambulance pick her up and get her to the hospital right away.
I'm much obliged.
See you later, Doctor.
Janet! Janet! Wake up!
Mrs. Gray.
Oh, what? What are you doing?
Mrs. Gray, will you please leave my office directly?
Happy to. I'm taking Janet with me.
Come on, Janet.
On your feet. We're getting out of here.
I'm in the middle of a consultation with Mrs. Barkley. How did you get into my office?
Hold on to my hand, Janet. That's the girl. You all right now? Out we go.
I insist that you leave
her. Listen, Doctor. I have a very important appointment with this lady, and you're preventing me from keeping it. She'll see you some other time.
What is all this about? Where are we going?
To my house. Second thought to yours, it's safer. Wait till I tell you the big news and you'll understand. Last night, Mike said maybe he was wrong. He'd go to California alone, I could keep the house. And let's seal the bargain with a kiss, he said. So I thought, well, what the heck, a marriage to this guy? Do you know what he did? He put his arms around me, and he held me like in a vise, and he kissed me until I couldn't breathe. I almost blacked out. Don't ask me how I got away. I just did. And it made me realize, Jeffrey, you and I are alone in this.
Yeah, there's an ambulance following us.
Ambulance?
It's practically right on top of us.
If we're being chased, let's give him a run for his money. That first side seat, that's wide enough. Okay?
Okay.
Now, here we go. Now, hold on.
You were right, Jeffrey. Why don't we pull up and just let him pass us?
No, I've got a hunch that's exactly what he wants us to do. We'll make that left up ahead. You ready for it?
Oh, Janet, I'm on the wrong way in a one-way street. There's a guy coming straight at us. Janet, get out. We've got to run for it. Janet, do you hear me? We can't stay here. Can't you move?
Hey, young lady.
You're not going to get me.
Janet, can you hear me? You're in the hospital. At your request, Janet, we're going to operate on you and see if we can bypass the occlusions that have made it difficult for you to get enough oxygen to your heart. Nurse, will you prop up Mrs. Barkley so she can sign this? It's a release form, Janet, so that Dr. Tyson and I can do all the procedures that are necessary. Would you just sign here, Janet? That's fine.
Yes. I signed it.
You will be anesthetized so you don't feel anything. We have a special operating room for cases like yours. I've got to say this, Dr. Tyson. Miss Janet Barkley is the most tenacious and courageous of her species.
Well, I have to agree with you. Originally, I wanted her destroyed. But I have come to realize we are going to be fortunate to have her stamina on Arcturus.
What about the other one, Celia Gray?
No, I think not. Let her go. The most I can say for her is that her heart's in the right place.
Hardly a suitable candidate for transportation, then.
No, not worth it. We want only the best types of mortals.
Bob?
She's conscious. I thought she was prepped and ready for the procedure.
Not quite yet. I want her to know what is happening to her.
Well, why didn't you just say triple bypass as we do to the others?
She never would have believed me. And she's not the kind to accept transferal to Arcturus without an
argument. I remind you, Dr. O'Brien, I am the one who makes our decisions on
Earth. But if you're the wise man we believe you are, you will accept my recommendations. I tell you, Janet will be cooperative and valuable if she knows. True, we exchanged all the others in the X and K batches for Arcturians without their knowledge. Aristotle, Dimitri, Willis, Michael. Even this girl's husband, James, transferred peacefully, quietly. In the end, Janet will transplant better than any so far. She is one of the true survivors of the best in mankind.
I take it, you wish to take charge of her.
I certainly do. Janet?
Yes?
Are you comfortable?
Yes.
You have heard Dr. Tyson and me talking, haven't you?
Yes.
Dr. Tyson comes from the planet Arcturus. He came here alone and then enrolled me. Arcturus is the only planet with the same characteristics as Earth, in atmosphere, soils, vegetation, and minerals. It is inhabited by Arcturians, creatures very like you and me. Inbreeding and disease have weakened Arcturians. And so Dr. Tyson was sent to Earth to secure the exchange of the finest species of mankind to that weakened planet. We're just beginning our work. It is accomplished by ionic transference.
My husband Jim would understand that, but he is in Greece.
No, Jim is closer than that to you. When you are fully anesthetized, a selected Arcturian,
similar in most characteristics, who replace what we on Earth used to call our soul. And your soul will find itself in an equally similar being on Arcturus.
You mean my husband has already been...
Yes, Janet. You were living with his replacement, who naturally assumed you were his original Arcturian mate. ZXY77.
No. No. No, let me go.
Janet, you don't understand. You will be joining your real husband. Not the James Barclay here on Earth, but the Jim Barclay, who at this moment is on Arcturus. Dr. Tyson, please stand by to begin.
How can I be sure? How can I know?
Dr. Tyson, could we make an exception?
Arrange for Mrs. Barclay to communicate with her husband on Arcturus.
It would help.
This is Dr. Tyson. Will you have Scientist Barclay in voice contact with us? His Earth wife, Janet Barclay, is here, ready for transference.
Janet? Are you there?
Jim?
Yes. It's me, Jim. I'm on the planet Arcturus. Come. Join me. Please come. There's no anger, Janet, and no death. It's like Earth, Janet, but better.
I always felt it wasn't you here. You weren't yourself.
Start. Start now. It only takes a little while and you'll be with me. Please come, Janet. I still love you.
Are you ready now, Janet?
Yes, I am. Jim, I'll be there soon. I love you too, Jim.
Should you come across a friend or relative acting in a way you believe is strange, rather than dismissing the incident by saying, oh, well, he's not himself, consider the possibility that he isn't. That by ion transference, the original person had been shipped off, shanghaied, if you will, to the planet Arcturus. Now, this account informs us that Arcturus is transplanting only the most brilliant of humans. So I guess most of us can feel safe in our own beds. I shall return shortly. Explorations in space, we are assured, have but scratched the surface of the cosmos. There are many worlds revolving about many suns. Listening devices have been set up here on Earth to receive any message issuing from any other planet, all because man cannot accept Earth to be the sole inhabited occupant of space. Perhaps we need the assurance that we are not alone. So, who can foretell? One day, many of us may transplant to other planets, whether they be Arcturus or not. Our cast included Marion Seldes, Patricia Elliott, Bob Caliban, and Earl Hammond. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.